Hey everyone, Shabby Gamer here, and welcome back to another episode of our WWE 2K16, 2K17 Universe Mode. I'm getting that wrong still. We're in Detroit, Michigan, and let's get this show straight underway. And here we see last week on Raw. An amazing, amazing performance there by Curtis Axel. Finishing off Braun Strowman 1-2-3, the first person to ever defeat Braun Strowman in the WWE was actually Curtis Axel. And you see the appreciation that was shown as he went backstage. General Manager Mick Foley was there waiting for him. And Mick Foley promising big things for Curtis Axel in the future if he can continue big, big victories like that. However, Braun Strowman was not very impressed. And later on that evening, referee looking into the locker room, unfortunately the only thing he found was a very, very angry Braun Strowman and Curtis Axel on a pile on the floor. Will Curtis Axel get some retribution this evening? We'll have to wait and see. Also, last week we saw a big match between two men during our triple threat match, and it was, of course, Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn. It ended with Sami Zayn being packaged piledrivered on the concrete floor outside. What sort of condition is he going to be in? I understand we're going to go straight away to Mick Foley in the ring to find out exactly where we are. And it looks like we are going to start things off with our general manager here, Mick Foley, making his way to the ring. We understand he has a few updates for us regarding the Royal Rumble. Of course, we need to get an update as well on the condition of Sami Zayn, who was viciously attacked by Kevin Owens last week and packaged piledrivered on the concrete floor outside the locker room. So we really need to get some sort of reflection on the condition of Sami Zayn. Will he be available to wrestle this Sunday at the Royal Rumble in that Universal Championship triple threat match? That is a big, big question on everyone's lips. So it'll be interesting to see exactly what Mick Foley has to say here. Dressed to impress, of course, in his suit and t-shirt. It's the best you're ever going to get at Mick Foley, isn't it, these days? But let's go straight to the ring and see what Mick Foley has got in his mind. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Monday Night Raw. Now, I'm out here to start the show, just to give a few updates on the Royal Rumble. The first thing I want to say is that we saw last week Curtis Axel get one of the biggest wins of his career, defeating Braun Strowman, the monster of the WWE. Now, later on that evening, we all saw what Braun Strowman did. He left Curtis Axel in a heap in the locker room. And Curtis is not here this evening. He's picked up quite a few injuries. Now, Curtis has begged me, though, over the phone. He wants retribution. Curtis Axel wants Braun Strowman at the Royal Rumble. Now, Braun is pretty intent in being in the Rumble, but I've offered Braun the opportunity to wrestle twice in that night, and he's quite happy to take on that challenge. He knows that he has the ability to do both them. Now, I thought this was a pretty suicidal move here by Curtis Axel, but he seems to think that he has something in the locker, a special weapon that will help him pick up this victory on Sunday. So we'll get to see what Curtis Axel really has up his sleeve. Also, due to the 20-woman Rumble, the iconic first time that we're going to see an all-female Rumble at the Royal Rumble pay-per-view. Basically, that means that there's going to be nobody available to wrestle Sasha Banks here, our women's champion on Raw. The problem with that is that Sasha Banks is one of the top women here in the WWE, and she deserves to be on the top pay-per-views, and of course, having the night off at the Royal Rumble is not what she wants to be doing. So I've combed through, and literally everybody on the entire roster, apart from one person, is going to be booked into that show. And that one person, of course, is going to be Becky Lynch. So what I'm proposing now to SmackDown is an inter-brand match. Champion versus champion at the Royal Rumble, Sasha Banks versus Becky Lynch. So Becky, the ball's in your court. Challenge has been put out there. Let us know if you accept this challenge. And lastly, the thing that everybody wants to know is the condition of Sami Zayn. Of course, last week we saw Kevin Owens assaulting Sami Zayn backstage and hit him with a package pile driver on the concrete outside the locker room. Now, unfortunately, I've been with the doctors all day and they have informed me that Sami Zayn will not be here this evening. However, he has been just about borderline cleared for Sunday. He's been advised not to wrestle, but Sami knows matches like this come around once in a blue moon and he has to take his opportunities when they arrive. So Sami has promised me that he's going to be 100% going into this Sunday. Now, I'm happy to give Sami this opportunity because I myself, over the years, have wrestled with pretty bad injuries. And I know the desire in your heart to win that championship when it is available. So good luck, Sami. I'll be watching this Sunday. And here is our first match of the evening. It is going to be Emma taking on Paige and Dana Brooke. Triple threat. A good chance for one of these three ladies to really pick up some big momentum going forward into that Royal Rumble match this Sunday. Be interesting this one. I would say probably Paige would be the strongest on paper, but we've not seen anything of Emma or Dana Brooke yet on this game. So it'd be interesting to see which one of these three ladies can really, really step up a level here this evening. And here is Paige.
One second. Some crazy shit going on. There you go, that's better. I'm disappearing. I'm going back. I'm going back.
I'm back. Yeah, so Paige, a woman that I don't think is going to be in the WWE for very long, to be brutally honest. I think she's a bit of a nutcase, in all fairness. I don't know if it's... She just seems a little bit out of it, doesn't she, really? She really does. She's, I don't really watch Total Divas, but I know one of my friends who does, and, I think Paige is just a bit... In fairness to her, she's probably, what is she, 22, 23-year-old woman, but from Norwich. And if you've ever been to the UK and you've been to Norwich, you know exactly what you're expecting from someone like Paige. But I don't know, she just seems to... It's a bit like Brian Kendrick. Brian Kendrick has always said that he was in the WWE too early in his career. Brian Kendrick was not ready for the WWE. He was still very, very much sort of immature in the head. And he really regrets that now because he has tried for his entire career to get back in the WWE. Of course, he has now. We're part of the Cruiserweight division, which is fantastic for him. And he's openly said that he was just too young at the time and just couldn't appreciate exactly what it is he had. And I think Paige might be in the very same ilk as that. I think she's going to end up probably ostracizing herself from the WWE at some point with the whole Del Rio situation and stuff like that. And then... I think eventually she'll sort of regret what she's done. However, she's probably earned enough money over these last couple of years to really give herself quite a comfortable life for the foreseeable future. And of course, if she does marry Del Rio, which apparently she did actually propose to Del Rio a few weeks back, and Del Rio apparently said yes at a live show, then I thought they've probably got quite a lot of money between them. I'm sure Paige will probably get a job in AAA, because I don't think AAA are really necessarily that bothered about crazy people, because... They're full of crazy people, aren't they, really, AAA? If you know a lot about Mexican wrestling, you'll know that backstage antics in Mexican wrestling is a lot worse than whatever is anywhere else. A lot of issues there. And here comes Dana Brooke. So, yeah, like I said, this is the first time I've actually seen Emma and Dana Brooke on this game. Well, Dana comes out with a flip, does she? That's a bit excessive. So, yeah, it's the first time I've seen these two ladies on the game, so it'll be interesting to see exactly how they act in the ring. I always thought Dana's entrance when she first started in NXT was really strange. I don't know if anyone out there has ever been to a strip club, but she just all of her movements just remind me. All she's missing is a pole, and she just looks like a stripper the whole time she's just moving around. She doesn't look right. I think it's not too bad now. She seems to have, since she's come into the main roster, I think she's improved a lot. She's sort of, there's still a few things she needs to improve on, but at the moment I think she's starting to understand her movements a lot better. And I think she's a good, strong asset as well. And when I say strong asset, I mean strong as in... Yeah, that's strong. It could be interesting as well. If Dana was to ever go face, which I don't think would go down too well, but if she was ever to go face, I think the potential feud between herself and Nia Jax could be interesting. Of course, Nia Jax will also be involved in that Rumble match. A lot of strength going into that 20-woman Rumble. This Sunday. And it'd be interesting because we do have, of course, we're really going to be bleeding the entire roster dry, apart from, as I mentioned earlier, as Mick Foley mentioned earlier on, and the only two women that are not going to be in that match that are on the roster are going to be Sasha Banks and Becky Lynch. Sasha Banks now has the challenge to Becky Lynch, champion versus champion for the Royal Rumble. Special attraction match, really, nothing really in that one. Apart from just the right to call yourself the best woman in the WWE. So there might have to be maybe one or two promotions from NXT or who knows, maybe even a legend or two popping back in that female Rumble. Now, I did mention this on SmackDown as well, but in case you missed it, there are going to be three Rumble matches at the Rumble. Of course, we have our standard 30-man Rumble at the end of the show. That's going to be our main event. We're going to have the 20-woman Rumble as well. And we're also going to have another 30-man Rumble, and that is going to be for legends. Now, when I say legends, I don't necessarily mean they have to be in the Hall of Fame or anything like that. Basically, I'm just saying legends, but it could be anybody who has wrestled for the WWE in the past. And, well, basically, that's it, really. Now, the idea of this third Rumble is the winner of the third Rumble will be given a place in this universe mode until the end, of course, which is going to be WrestleMania. So that's pretty interesting. That could be literally anyone. There is going to be quite a few people in that Rumble. Of course, we've got the legends in the game. We've got quite a few that I've downloaded as well. Now, when I say legends, we are going to see quite a few people from the late 80s and early 90s and mid-90s. But then we are also going to see people in there more likely like Shawn Michaels. Well, I don't know, because there's some people that we're going to bring in for WrestleMania anyway. I don't really want to spoil too much. But there's some people who will probably be brought in for WrestleMania anyway. So maybe there'll be a few that are probably missing that you might assume are going to be in there. I think we're probably going to probably look for more along the Legends Rumble. We're probably going to look for more along the lines of the early 90s, late 80s, or basically anybody you would expect to see in a Royal Rumble. And I will say as well, as part of this universe mode, when we get into this Rumble, it's going to have legends in there. I'm not going to make this overly realistic. For example, there may be people in this Rumble that unfortunately are no longer with us. So if you see Rowdy Roddy Piper, or if you see... I'm trying to tell you people that aren't completely out of the blue, that aren't big spoilers at the same time. So yeah, there will be some people in there that might not be alive at the moment. And I don't really want to stop... obviously, Kurt Hennig, Mr. Perfect could be another one as well. I don't really want to stop... I don't really want to stop them being in there just because they're not alive. I want to try and remember these people to the best of their ability. It's just because somebody dies, it doesn't mean we have to just completely ignore them. So that's the reason why I will be including people like that in that Rumble. But of course, the winner of that Rumble, like I said, will be given a permanent place on the roster up until the end of this universe mode, which of course will be WrestleMania. Wow, Emma goes high there. Paige launched over the top rope. And now, what's Paige looking for here? She's going to go for a dive there, but Dana Brooke comes out and takes Emma down. And I do like the triple threats on this year's game. I think they do work really, really well. And of course now with Sasha Banks defeating Charlotte last week for the Women's Championship, that means that Charlotte will be involved in this Rumble coming up this week as well. Just to give you a few more names, obviously, if you look on Raw, Raw's really strong. You've got Charlotte, you've got Bayley, Dana Brooke, Paige, Emma... Nia Jax, Alicia Fox. What's that? That's seven just off the top of my head. Then on SmackDown, you've of course got Alexa Bliss, Natalia, Nikki Bella, Naomi, Carmella. So there's a lot of names that are going to be in there. Of course, we are going to have to make it up, like I said, with a few, maybe NXT or maybe a couple of Legend women as well here and there, just to try and boost that roster up. But again, the winner of the Women's Rumble will be treated the same as the Male Rumble and will be given a match against their respective champion at WrestleMania. Now, will the champions still be Sasha Banks and Becky Lynch? Now, both of those ladies I can see defending their championship at least once more before Mania, and that's probably going to be our second pay-per-view, which I'm still trying to decide which our second pay-per-view should be. I was always a big fan of the Elimination Chamber, but maybe that's a little bit over the top. Maybe we could do, I think last year, was it Fastlane? They did last year, but I'm not a big fan of Fastlane. I always liked No Way Out. No Way Out was always a pay-per-view I enjoyed. So maybe if No Way Out's on the game, I might go for that, because I always liked that. It's been quite a good matchup between these three ladies so far. Spinning neckbreaker there by Dana Brooke. Now, Dana can pull off a win here. That'd be fantastic for her. Paige is on the outside, and Dana goes to the pin here on Emma. 1, 2. No, Emma does kick out. Of course, I think both Emma and Paige both utilise a submission finish. So that could be interesting. We have now obviously seen a submission victory. We saw that on SmackDown in the last episode. I won't say who it was just in case you haven't watched it, but we've seen our first submission victory. Dana now hooking the leg. 1, 2. And Paige does get there just in time. Literally... a fraction just on time to break that pin. Now, Dana, can you go for the pin again? Well, if I was Dana, though, I would have gone for the pin again straight away on Ember once I'd taken Paige down. But Dana, showing her inexperience, really. She's not been wrestling for that long. Just rubbing the face of Paige into the mat and dropping an elbow right into the center of the back as well. Now, I need to try and think about what sort of universe mode we are going to do after this one. Of course, we've still got a while in this one to go because, like I said, I'm not going to rush the episodes this time. I think I did a little bit too much last year. I sort of burnt myself out. But at the same time, I ended up going for quantity over quality. And this year, I really want to try and go for quality. There's the pin once again by Dana. She's got her feet up on the ropes, which doesn't matter in this type of match. It's triple threat, which is no disqualification. But Paige does kick out. One thing I do want from you guys as well, if you are, I know a lot of people probably skip the women's match, but if you are still watching them, please let me know, did you prefer that promo at the beginning of the show? So basically what I've done is I've used some footage I've been able to cut together, I've downloaded some crowd noise off YouTube as well, and I've tried to mix it all together to create our own promo. Do you think that was a better idea? Would you prefer to see that rather than me trying to use the in-game promo system? Because I think it sort of makes more sense because we can act our promos along with the current storylines that are going on. But let me know, would you rather me stick to doing that sort of promo or would you rather me use the in-game promos? Let me know what you think. As Paige now has Emma locked in here to the single leg Boston Crab. Dana Brooke is down and Emma does fight free. Kick to the face of Paige. Paige slowly back up to her feet, but Emma catches her. It was almost like a half Nelson there. Dana straight across, running neckbreaker on Emma. Emma slides straight out of the ring. And now Dana looking for a surfboard submission hold as well. Beautiful move here by Dana Brooke on Paige. Locking in that surfboard submission. Are we going to see another submission win here? No, Paige manages to flop free into a pin. Boots the gut of Dana. Now Paige hooking the leg. Going to go for a rampage. She hits it. Emma's still down on the outside. Can Paige get the pin? Just to drag Dana away from the ropes. There's the pin now. Emma's slowly getting back up. One, two. Can she get there in time? Oh my God, she did just get there in time. Wow, what a triple threat this has been. These three ladies doing so well. Crucifix bomb there by Paige. And now wrenching back at Emma. Oh, that's a really got a tied up in a bow there. Paige dropping into the pin on Emma once again. One, two. Oh, and again, Emma just about kicks out as Dana Brooke just taunting now. Dana straight across breaking the submission hold there. Paige rolls to the outside. Now Dana looking to continue the assault here on Emma. There's the flatliner. And now Dana once again going for a submission hold of her own. Surfboard just has Emma tied up there. Are we going to see another submission win? It looks like it's going submission this match, doesn't it, really? And Paige does come in and break it. Paige now sending Dana Brooke into the corner. Hoists her up onto the top. Paige is going to follow Dana up there. What's she looking for here? It's high risk and it's high impact. Super back suplex there by Paige on Dana Brooke. Paige needs to go for the pin. She does roll Dana over into the pin. One, two, only a two count. Now, one thing, sorry, if you did watch the episode of SmackDown, you will know that I had a major issue in the tag team number one contendership match. We had American Alpha versus The Ascension. I got really annoyed when American Alpha hit their finishing maneuver and the referee did not count the pin. Apparently that was a glitch in the game and it has been fixed in a patch that's just been released. And Emma's going to get this one. She does. Emma picks up the victory with that big scoop slam on Paige. So it's Emma who picks up the win and picks up the momentum going forward into our Rumble match this Sunday at the Royal Rumble. Will we possibly be seeing Emma at WrestleMania facing off against the Raw Women's Champion? I won't say who it could be, but obviously it could be Sasha Banks, but there's always another person that could take their belt away from Sasha beforehand. And here is our second match of the evening. Again, two men that will be in the Royal Rumble. Of course, the world's strongest athlete, Mark Henry, taking on Darren Young. Interesting match, this one. Darren Young's got the youth behind him, Whereas Mark Henry, of course, has the strength. So it'd be interesting to see if the strength of Mark Henry can bring him through this one. First time we've really seen Mark Henry as well in this game. Not really using him. I don't think I've used Darren Young either. That's the thing about the universe, mate. Of course, we've been doing the random match series, which there should have been a match uploaded today as well. We've been doing the random match series, but on top of that, we've been doing the universe mode now. And the random match series, everyone, of course, picks their favourite wrestlers. So it's been pretty much the same people over and over again, really. And I don't mind that. The people that have been picked are very, very good wrestlers. However, by using the universe mode, we get to use people like Mark Henry and Darren Young to see exactly what they are like in-game. Same thing we just saw with Dana Brooke and Emma there as well. I was thoroughly impressed with both those ladies, actually. They were very, very strong. And Emma obviously picking up the win. I thought Paige was going to come out on top of that one, but Emma picking up the win shows the strength and depth that we do have on this roster. And here comes Darren Young. I would be half tempted to put Darren Young back with Titus O'Neil and go back with the primetime players. I'm a little bit confused why WWE keep putting them together, splitting them up, putting them together, splitting them up, putting them together, splitting them up. It seems a bit odd to me. I would like to see a little bit more, really. But maybe we could put them back together. Raw-wise, we've got quite a few tag teams on Raw. We do have a tag team match coming up for you later on this evening. We are going to see the first appearance of the club in our universe mode. Of course, the club will be the real version downloaded soon when the DLC finally comes out. There's still no... I don't think there's any release dates for the DLC. Let me just Google it quickly while I'm here. Google. 2K17 DLC release dates. Let's see if they've actually released some release dates now. Release some release dates. Well, in the recent patch that was released, that's just been downloaded as I started the game up, the Legends pack has been put onto the game in preparation. Now, who was in the Legends pack? Was that the... who was in the Legends pack? So it looks like the Legends pack will be the first one released. So the Legends pack was... Bruce Barber Beefcake, Eddie Guerrero, Greg the Hammer Valentine, Psycho Sid, and Tatanka. Okay, that looks like it's going to be the first of the DLC packs then. Which I was hoping to get the Future Stars pack first, to be honest with you. But because of the Austin Aries, Carl Anderson... Well, because obviously Carl Anderson, Luke Gallows, Mojo Rawley are all on the main roster now, I thought it was a bit obvious to put them one out first. But it doesn't look like that has been the case. Of course, Austin Aries is on there as well, and Ty Dillinger. I'm really looking forward to that pack, actually. And the Hall of Fame Showcase pack will be interesting as well. What I'll probably do is I won't do the retro universe mode until we've done our Hall of Fame Showcase. When that's been released, then we'll do the retro universe. Because then we'll have Brutus Beefcake, we'll have Greg the Hammer Valentine, and we'll also have the Fabulous Freebirds and the Von Erichs. Papa Shango. So we'll have quite a few extras that we can use in that pack. And again, I don't really want to do NXT until I've got Austin Aries and Ty Dillinger as well. So I think by the time we've finished this universe mode, maybe we can look at it a bit more and we can decide what we want to do. We could always do something a little bit different. We can go for maybe a Lucha Underground for... So what I'm going to do basically with all the universe modes is I'm going to just run them for 3 months. 3 in-game months. Of course, if you're doing something like Lucha Underground, then it'll just be weekly shows, and then maybe we'll do like a special show every 5 shows as almost like a pay-per-view, I suppose. Again, Ring of Honor, we'll just do 3 months, so we'll just weekly shows every week, and then a pay-per-view every month as well. So there's really a lot we can do, and I think we will at some point, of course, as well, do our own universe mode, but I think I want to try and stick to the real stuff for now. We can do an Attitude Era 1 as well. Somebody suggested maybe do an Attitude Era 1 where we had WWF, WCW, and ECW, which could be a possibility of doing that as well. Or maybe I might just do like WWF and WCW, and then do ECW in a separate one. Because I'm thinking we can always do like two brands at the same time in each universe mode, so maybe we could do it that way. Do like a Monday Night Wars. I know, we'll have a look. I suppose it's pointless thinking too far ahead. We haven't finished this one yet. I need to try and get some more episodes uploaded on this one. I want to try and get the Rumble uploaded this weekend, but I don't know if that's going to be possible because I am actually working this weekend. So it's all about me trying to find the time to do the recordings over the evening. And because obviously I'm trying to put more into these episodes and trying to give you a little bit more special effects going forward, if that makes sense. Like the promos and the previously little bits at the beginning of the show. It's taken me a lot longer to do the editing. Not necessarily the recording. The recording's fine. I'll sit down and do that in one go as long as my recording software doesn't bug out on me. I can sit down and do that all in one go. But it's all about that editing and putting the show together to make it seem like a proper show. So that takes a bit of time. So I'll try and see what I can do. Like I say, I would really like to get it recorded this, get it uploaded this weekend. For me, I think it's always best to get things uploaded at the weekends because you get a lot more views then. But of course, we do still have an episode of SmackDown to put on this as well. So it could be difficult. I think it might end up being uploaded Sunday evening or Sunday night. I'll see what I can do. As Mark Henry now sending Darren Young into the corner with some force. And shoulder first into the steel turnbuckle. Now the thing is with Mark Henry is because he's such a big man, he often gets picked on in Rumbles. And it's difficult for him really. Same with the Big Show. Because the Big Show is a big man, everyone just sort of goes after him. Mark Henry now just pinching the trapezius of Darren Young. Very, very painful as well. There's a scoop slam there by Mark Henry and then going junkyard dog style with a headbutt. Mark Henry. Big splash on Darren Young. There's the pin. One, two, and three. And Mark Henry does use his strength to win this match here. Darren Young looked pretty strong for quite a chunk of it. But it is Mark Henry who comes out on top. And the momentum going forward, he's going to want that win. He's going to want the momentum. He knows how big the Rumble is for him. He knows at his age, World Championship matches are few and far become. Few and far between. And he knows that he has to take his opportunities where he can get them. And the Royal Rumble is a great chance for Mark Henry to main event WrestleMania one more time in his career. And here is our next match of the evening. It's going to be an Elimination Tornado Tag Match. The Club, Luke Gallows and Karl Anderson take on the Dudley Boys, Bubba Ray Dudley and D-Von. Should be an interesting match, this one. And here we go. Long loading screens in tag team matches still, which is a little bit disappointing. Yeah, I'm looking forward to getting these two guys as DLC just to get rid of the fake entrance music and to get the obviously the real scans on there as well, because I think the Luke Gallows is quite good. The Karl Anderson face is not perfect, but the attires are quite good. But of course, we're getting the DLC. We'll get the exact models, correct entrance music, correct entrance videos, correct entrance movements as well, correct move sets. Everything like that is going to be spot on. So I'm looking forward to getting that. Looking very Nation of Domination there. It is Nation of Domination as well. I thought it was looking very Nation for us. That's all right. That's fine for them too, I think. That suits them-ish. Good chance to see these two in action then. I think we may have seen them once already, but because of the glitch in my save file and having the whole thing deleted and having to restart again, I think this might be a different version than what I originally had. But because I'm looking forward to getting the real ones, but by the looks of the patch and everything that's happened, it looks like that we are going to get the Legends pack first, which is not really going to help us too much. There's not really a lot on there we'll probably use straight away. Don't be wrong, I'm quite happy to get Eddie Guerrero, Psycho Sid, Grade the Hammer Valentine, and Brutus the Barber Beefcake, but they're not really ones we're going to use in this universe mode. Although, you never know, we could use Guerrero at some point. Maybe bringing Guerrero back for WrestleMania could be a good shout. I think our WrestleMania card is going to be freaking huge. So, definitely worth watching out that. Our Royal Rumble card so far is at 12 matches. And like I said, that's probably going to come up as three separate videos. So we'll have the first video will be sort of like, it won't be a pre-show. We'll have the first video and it will finish with a Royal Rumble before matches. The second video, again, three matches in a Royal Rumble. And the fourth video will be three matches and a Royal Rumble. So we're going to have a Rumble in each video, which is going to probably mean that the whole pay-per-view itself is probably going to last around about 3 hours. So I'm hoping you guys are up for that. It's going to be a lot of viewing, but of course, you have to watch it all in one go, do you? That's the thing, I suppose. I'm really looking forward to doing that now. I sort of want to get this and SmackDown out of the way just so we can get to the Rumble, because I'm really excited. I mean, come on, think about it. Brock Lesnar, Kevin Owens, and Sami Zayn. Triple threat. AJ Styles versus Randy Orton for the championship on the other show as well. Got Ziggler versus Apollo Crews. We've got Roman Reigns versus Rusev for the United States Championship. We've got some really good matches. Have we got the New Day down for anything? I don't think we have we? I don't think the New Day. Oh, yeah, no, yeah, the New Day are defending their tag team championships against Enzo and Cass. We know that as well. What else we got? Sasha Banks versus Becky Lynch proposed as well. Strowman versus Axel. Of course, on SmackDown, it was also announced that it was going to be the Revival versus TM61. The winning team will get a place on the SmackDown roster. Rhino and Heath Slater defending their tag team championships against American Alpha. Brian Kendrick is going to be challenging TJ Perkins for the Cruiserweight Championship. So really, I've got a real packed out card for you. Of course, we've got the 30-man Legends Rumble for a place on the roster. We've got the 20 female Rumble for a championship match at WrestleMania, and the 30-man Rumble for the match at WrestleMania as well. So it's going to be a massive, massive card, Royal Rumble, and it's going to be huge. I'm really looking forward to it. So remember, as I said earlier on, this is an elimination match. So essentially, both members of the team need to be pinned to lose this match. Or you have to pin both members to win the match. That, yeah, either way, it makes the same thing, doesn't it? Gallows now with a pin on Devon pretty early on. It's not going to be enough, though, is it, really? And again, there's nothing really to this match. It literally is just a match to build some more momentum. I should imagine a few of these guys, if not all three of them, will be part of our Royal Rumble. What I want to do really is I want to make sure that everybody involved in the Rumble has a very good chance of winning it. And I want to make sure that if whoever wins the Rumble, I want to make sure that whoever's in the Rumble, if they win it, I'm not going to be disappointed. That's the words I'm looking for. Because in my very first Rumble I did on WWE 2K15, it was won by Virgil. And the match set for WrestleMania was Virgil versus The Undertaker. And that's the main reason why I stopped. And I started again a little bit later on. But I want to make sure that whoever we do put into the game, whoever we do put into the Rumble, I wouldn't be disappointed in headlining Mania. And again, I'm not going to give away too many things, but there will be some surprises here and there at the Rumble. I'm going to promise that. I've been trying to get a hold of the Shockmaster, but he's not answering the calls at the moment. So I want to see if we can get the Shockmaster on the show. See if he can break through a wall and keep his mask on for a change. Good old Shockmaster. What a disaster that was. Bubba Ray now bringing Anderson up. Big clubbing blow against the back. And Bubba there with the shake, rattle and roll. And Carl Anderson's actually been busted open. Another tag team maneuver there by the Dudley Boys, taking Luke Gallows down. Maybe this is an opportunity for the Dudley Boys to get an elimination. Of course, one elimination is going to be a really, really massive boost to one of these two teams. Because then it allows you to go 2-on-1 for the remainder of the match. And obviously that's going to be much easier for you. Devon now with a pin on Gallows. Anderson didn't notice, but super kicks Bubba Ray out of his boots. Anderson now just slamming down on the knee of Bubba as Devon with the elbow drop to the back of Gallows. And so far it's a pretty even match solely because, well, one member of each team is in control, I suppose. Devon now taking Gallows up onto the top. What's Devon got planned? Superplex on the middle rope. Devon struggling to get back up though. Anderson's pinning Bubba. Only a one count. Referee was very, very slow to get there, I must admit. And again, Devon throwing Gallows into the corner. It's almost like a race here. Devon dominating Gallows. Anderson dominated Bubba. Whichever one of these two guys gets the pin first is going to have a massive, massive advantage. Elbow dropped by Bubba. And now all of a sudden, both members of the Dudley Boys are in control of this match. The club cannot be happy with this. Devon bringing Gallows back up, sending him into the corner. There's the elbow drop by Bubba. Devon loves the turnbuckle, doesn't he? He keeps sending him into the corner over and over and over again. But Gallows, oh, tripping Devon, landing first face on the mat. First face? Face first on the mat. The pin by Bubba. Gallows breaks it up. Catching Bubba. Looking for a four-way slam, but Bubba breaks free with them back elbows. Now take, oh my god, look at this. The strength of Bubba Ray Dudley. Gorilla press on Gallows, and Devon just falls straight into the pin. It's not quite enough though. Good bit of teamwork, isn't it? That was how much that intended that was by Bubba. Oh, Anderson out of nowhere with the cutter. And a bulldog on Bubba. If Anderson get the pin here on Devon, he might just get it. Oh, come on, Anderson. You've got to go for the pin there on Devon. Black hole slam as well. Anderson just turning this match upside down. He just doesn't seem to want to go for the pin while the other person's on their feet, though. Gallows now trying to catch Devon unaware, as he did, but Devon continues the assault. Gallows backbreaker on Bubba Ray Dudley. Now Gallows lining Bubba up. Takes him up. Spinning sit out powerbomb. Now Gallows, you've got to go for the pin. You've got to go for the pin, Gallows. You just hit your finisher maneuver. You've got to go for the pin. This is not working very well, this game mode, is it? Not working very well. Sit out. Double-handed chokeslam by Devon Dudley. Now dropping in a headbutt into the delicate area there of Luke Gallows. Well, I still have to keep reminding myself not to call him Doc. I bet I've called him Doc Gallows a few times already, haven't I? Anderson now with Bubba up in a torture rack and spins him into the neck breaker. Now is Anderson going to go for the pin? He probably should do here. Go on, Anderson. Go for the pin. Devon is down. Anderson does not go for the pin. He brings him back up to his feet. I've got a question. Question the AI here, because it's just not going for the kill when it probably should be. Gallows. Gorilla press. I understand it makes sense to go for the guy who's on his feet before going for the pin, but well, Anderson trying to sneak in here, and Anderson does sneak in behind the back of Devon. It's only a two count though, and Devon catching the big diving uppercut on Luke Gallows. Big right hand. Going for that reverse suplex, that Bloody Sunday, that 1960, whatever you want to call it. Devon, you've got to pin him, Devon. Devon, that's your finisher. Pin him. Oh, God, this game. This game is so screwed. It's not even funny half the time. It really is. Bubba Bomb. Bubba, are you going to go for the pin? Why are you not pinning people for? You've just hit your finisher maneuver. Let your tag team partner block off the other person and win. This game is freaking crazy. It really is. I think elimination matches are dead on this game. I really do. The elimination chamber match we did on the random match didn't work at all because people wouldn't go for pins after their finisher maneuver. And it seems to be the same way here. I understand the AI behind going for the person who's on his feet, but at the same time, they're hitting their finisher maneuver and their partner's attacking somebody. And instead of going for the pin and letting their partner take out the opponent, they're not doing that. They're going to try and help take down the other opponent. There we go now. Carl Anderson is going for a pin as Luke Gallows has Bubba under control. Gallows, big sit-out powerbomb, holds it in for the pin. This has got to be one, two, and there we go. There goes Bubba Ray. We're now down to 2-on-1. The club versus Devon Dudley. And finally, it was just been a pretty good match, apart from just the not going for the pin after finishes, which is just frustrating me a bit. And that looked like an absolute mess. That looks like Karl Anderson may have just need his tag team partner Luke Gallows in the head. I think another part of the AI could just be like to stand back and watch your opponent actually hit a maneuver and then wait for your turn to hit one yourself. The problem is that everyone tries to get a bit too involved, don't they? Everyone in the match just tries to get involved in everything that's going on, and that causes problems. Anderson now sending Devon into the corner. Devon fights back. Big spinebuster by Devon. Anderson just kicks Devon in the head straight into the path of Luke Gallows, and Devon fights back with that elbow, sending Gallows into the corner. And now when Anderson should be getting, there we go, Anderson does finally get involved. A big clothesline to the lower back of Devon, spins him round. Not quite sure what's going on here. Cuts him down. I think Anderson, that's a pin there, referee, technically. Devon had landed on the top of Luke Gallows, should have been a pin. Anderson now just wrenching back at the face of Devon. If he knows what's good for him, he probably should tap out here. He needs to live to fight another day. He knows fighting against both members of the club is not a good situation for him to be in. However, I also think he can quite easily reach the ropes from there, but he didn't seem to pull ring position, I think, really. Luke Gallows sending Devon into the corner. Anderson with a big kick to the gut. Oh. There's just too much, isn't there? In this situation where it's 2-on-1, it's a little bit too much. Everyone just tries to get involved in everything. They don't allow the opposing person to hit a big maneuver. That's the problem, I think. It's a bit of a shame, really. But still, it's working pretty well, this match type. Apart from the major problem, of course, with not pinning after finisher maneuvers, which I think shouldn't be an issue now because it is 2-on-1. Gallows is... What are you doing? Gallows didn't even want to go for the pin there, but looks like he got straight out of it. Bringing Devon back up. Devon with the uppercut. How many reversals does Devon have here? Atomic drop. But Anderson straight away catching Devon with the Fez press. Big boot in the face of Devon. And again, just wrenching back at his neck. This time, a bit more inside the ring. The damage has been done from the last one. It's sort of like a very, very loose camel clutch by Karl Anderson. Devon does break free. Gallows taking Devon up onto the shoulders. There's the big flapjack. And surely that's going to be enough. Someone pin him. Go on. Somebody. One of you. One of you pin him. What are they doing? Oh, they're either both trying to get... Or they're both just standing off doing nothing. Now, finally, Anderson does go for a pin. One, two, and no, Devon kicked out. Devon Dudley kicks out. Gallows in the corner now, taking a break. Karl Anderson with a big super kick. Gallows now dragging Devon into the middle of the ring. And again, neglecting to go for the pin, but now Gallows locking in a stretch muffler. I do enjoy a good stretch muffler. Of course, finisher maneuver used by former NXT wrestler Solomon Crowe, or better known on the indie circuit as Sami Callihan. Karl Anderson now. Oh, they're going to go for a magic killer. There we go. Tag team finisher maneuver now for surely. This is going to be enough. And there we go. It is enough. The club do pick up a big victory here. Although both members busted open by the Dudley Boys, they do pick up a big victory here in this tag team match. That's going to help boost them up the tag team rankings here, potentially looking for a championship match in the future. Of course, the number one contendership match was between Enzo and Cass and the Dudley Boys last week. So Gallows and Anderson probably putting themselves around about third in the rankings now. Behind, of course, Enzo and Cass, the number one contenders, and, of course, the champions, the New Day. So a great win here for the club. And here is our next match. It is going to be the Swiss Superman Cesaro taking on one half of the number one contenders for the Tag Team Championships, of course, Big Cass. And of course, it's not enough to just have Big Cass in the ring. You need to have Enzo Amore at ringside, don't you? That's the best way forward. That's the best way forward. And here comes Cesaro. Somebody who I really would like to see further up the card. Of course, Cesaro is going to be somebody involved in the Royal Rumble. Someone who I think has got a really, really big future in the WWE. Once they finally pull the trigger and give him the opportunity, I think he's going to be a very good wrestler. A very good potential world champion as well. Like I said, he just needs to be given that... He needs to be given that opportunity. He needs to be given that one sort of championship. And then all of a sudden... It's a bit like Kevin Owens. A lot of people sort of didn't think WWE would pull the trigger on Owens. But now he's been the champion once. You can see him being the champion quite a few times during his career. He's very, very good at it. And I think Cesaro would be somebody who should really get an opportunity as well. However, I think Cesaro is very unhappy. And there's rumours that he may leave the WWE at the end of this contract. Which for me would be very, very disappointing. I'm a big fan of Cesaro. And his massive areolas. But yeah, I'm a massive fan of Cesaro. And if he did leave, then it'd be disappointing. But to see him back in places like PWG and stuff like that would be fantastic. And I think he would be a massive, massive asset to someone like New Japan as well. But that's sort of one of the rumours why Cesaro has been stuck in this whole little feud slash tag team thing with Sheamus. They're just doing something with him just to keep him occupied until his contract does come up. I'm hoping that's incorrect, and I've got a feeling it may be incorrect. But I would love to see Cesaro potentially move across to SmackDown. That's what I want to see. I want to see maybe some draft or maybe his contract expiring, that sort of thing, and allowing Cesaro to move across to SmackDown, because he would be a massive asset to SmackDown. Because for me, Jack Swagger is just not anything special, is he, really? And he's the only person that's gone from SmackDown, from Raw to SmackDown, is Jack Swagger. And it doesn't give enough... For me, it just doesn't give enough sort of a boost to SmackDown. SmackDown's good, but it's got a very, very thin roster. And once you get past that thin roster, there's not a lot of depth in there. S-A-W-F-T, SWAT. Yeah, I think SmackDown's got a very thin roster. And for me, Raw got 66% of the wrestlers because they're a three-hour show compared to a two-hour show. They also then got Bayley. They got a couple of returns as well, didn't they? They got Jinder Mahal as well. But then they've also got about 12 new wrestlers as part of the Cruiserweight division as well. So all of a sudden, Raw is just getting more and more and more. I think what should have happened is SmackDown should have got the Cruiserweight division. And that would have made up for all the extra wrestlers that Raw had taken away from them. Plus, SmackDown has a much better writing team by the looks of it. Based on the shows and the rivalries that have been put out so far, I think SmackDown has a better writing team. And I think SmackDown would have been able to do a lot more with the Cruiserweights. Raw at the moment... Raw's treating the Cruiserweights like a freaks. Whenever the Cruiserweights come down, they have to change the apron. They have to change the ropes. They have to change the turnbuckle pads. They're not really given much of a chance to show storylines. They're not really given much of a chance at all. And I think they should... I don't think they should just class it as a whole separate thing. I think they should just integrate all the Cruiserweights into the Raw roster and just make sure that it's only them who goes for the championship. There's no reason... Just because someone like... For example, Cedric Alexander is a Cruiserweight. Does not mean he should be limited to just the Cruiserweight division. He should be able to go off and do stuff with other people. Maybe Cedric Alexander could go off and have a feud with, I don't know, some random person. I don't know, Braun Strowman versus Cedric Alexander. Who knows? And then it gives... Let me know that Cedric can always come back and go for the Cruiserweight Championship. It's a little bit of a tricky one. Now, I know the reason why they've taken the championship away from... away from TJ Perkins, I believe, he's got something to do with them wanting to mix up the Cruiserweight division a bit more and having different potential champions going forward. I'm hoping they've not done it because they don't think that TJ Perkins is a good enough champion and he's not getting enough of a reaction, because the whole Cruiserweight division is not getting enough of a reaction, in my opinion. I think it's really, really cheeky, actually. I think they need to really be given more of an opportunity. They need to be given more of a chance to show exactly what they can do. And I think that's only going to come from allowing them to get on the mic and talk a bit, create their own rivalries, create their own feuds, maybe even get a couple of tag teams at the Cruiserweight division. Why not make a tag team of, well, what was it? Was it TJ Perkins and Kota Ibushi wrestled together in the NXT tag team tournament? So why not mix a tag team up and try and get them involved in the tag team division? Well, that's what I said. They just don't want to just compress themselves into this one division. They need to spread them around. They need to give them an opportunity to really show what they can do. And I think it'd be good once someone like Enzo Amore gets an opportunity as well to be... I'm sure Enzo could be part of the Cruiserweight division. He's one of the tiniest men I've ever seen in my entire life. I'm sure Enzo could be part of the Cruiserweight division. As now, this match is getting pretty brutal, actually, on the outside. Now, both these guys need to be careful because we know that Cesaro is going to be part of the Royal Rumble, so he doesn't want to get any unnecessary injuries. And at the same time, we know that Big Cass has got a tag team championship match this Sunday against the New Day alongside Enzo Amore. So, again, he doesn't want to take any injuries, unnecessary injuries, into that match. We can see a double counter. We've already seen a double counter once or twice on this game. Referee's allowing him a bit extra time here. Come on. Get back in the ring. And they do get back in the ring on a 9 count. God, it's so bloody close, isn't it? So close. And now Big Cass lines Cesaro up for that big spinning side dot slam. There's the pin. 1, 2, and 3. A massive win here for Big Cass over Cesaro. And that's going to... I like the whole Enzo thing on the apron. That's pretty cool, actually. So that's going to be pretty cool, actually. I'm thinking that Big Cass has built himself a massive amount of... Where Enzo disappeared all of a sudden. A massive amount of momentum going forward into that tag team championship match against the New Day. And I really would like to hit the refresh button on the tag team division on Raw, because I think the New Day have just been champions for far too long, in my opinion. Over 400 days now. It's just too much. Talking of the New Day, our next match is going to be Kofi Kingston taking on Finn Balor. And, of course, Xavier Woods and Big E Langston will be at ringside. Now, of course, the New Day being the tag team champions, I'm still pretty tempted to put at least Kofi Kingston into the Rumble, because he's always good for a decent match, isn't he, Kofi Kingston in the Rumble? I need to try and work out the numbers and who we're going to put in there. I wanted to put a 40-man Rumble on there. And the thing that gets me is on the patch notes for the new patch they've just released that I've downloaded today, it says that they've improved some of the issues with 40-man Rumbles. I'm sat there thinking there's no such thing as a 40-man Rumble in this game. Have they added it? But no, I still can't find the 40-man Rumble. There's only 30-person Rumbles. And that's it's a little bit annoying. I think they should let you have as many people as you want in a Rumble. I think they should let you have like 120 if you want. If you're willing to sit there, then have 120 men in the Rumble. Why not? New Day rocks. New Day rocks. New Day rocks. So they are the tag team champions. Now, I got it completely wrong at the beginning of the Universe Mode. I thought that Kofi Kingston and Big E Langston were the tag team champions, but it turns out it's actually Kofi Kingston and Xavier Woods. So I would say Big E Langston is definitely going to be in the Rumble. And I'm thinking of putting Kofi in there as well. I'll have to try and work it out. I'll have to try and do... I love their entrance, New Day. It's so mental, isn't it? I'll have to try and do a little note down and try and figure out who's going to be in there. So one of the things that I've noticed in this game as well, what I thought was really good, actually, was the fact that you can have more than one manager now. And that's one of the main things about this game that I'm liking, especially in this match right here, because we know it's going to be Xavier Woods in the ring, and he's going to be joined by both... It's going to be Kofi Kingston in the ring. And both Xavier Woods and Big E Langston are going to be at ringside as managers. So both of those people as managers are really going to probably affect Finn Balor to quite some effect. But we'll see what happens. Of course, Finn Balor, another man who would definitely be in the Rumble. And I'd love to see Finn Balor main event WrestleMania. Although if not, I do have some certain ideas for Finn Balor, some stuff that we can give him to do. I do have a headache. That's quite painful. Ow. That's too much bloody... I've spent about 2 hours editing stuff before I've even started recording this video. And it's giving me a bit of a headache now. But oh, we've only got this match and the main event left. Of course, the main event I will tell you right now, we are going to see Brock Lesnar accompanied to the ring by Paul Heyman, and he's going to be taking on Chris Jericho. And of course, you've guessed it, he'll be accompanied to the ring by Big Kev, Kevin Owens. So really interesting match there, really interesting dynamic. We know that Kevin Owens tried to take out Sami Zayn last week, tried to take out one of his opponents for the Rumble. Is he going to try his luck here this evening against Brock Lesnar? That's going to be interesting, interesting one, that. Do, 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 do. I do love Finn Balor's entrance. I've got some special attires set up for him as well throughout this universe mode. I think we'll probably see... I'm thinking we'll probably see Finn Balor on all the three pay-per-views. And I've got a different attire set for each pay-per-view. So it's going to be interesting. I'm looking forward to doing that, actually. And I've already got ideas for each of the attires. So in fairness, it would probably bugger me up if Finn Balor won the Rumble. But I'm not going to moan. If Balor does win the Rumble, I'm more than happy. You can't see, but I just did the Finn Balor arms out. I'm that sad. I just do it by myself in my flat. Doo-dee-doo-bee-doo-bee-doo. Dooby 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 doo. Yeah, I'll stop making noises now. I'm sorry. Doo doo. You can't help but just sing along to this song. That's the problem. So here we go. What effect is both Biggie Langston? Oh, wow. I did not know that happens. Xavier Woods plays the trumpet while he's at the ringside. Oh, we are doing a lot of these. We are definitely going to be doing a lot of these. I want to see more of Xavier Woods at ringside for matches. I don't know what Big... Is Big E going to do anything against Well? I don't know if Big E's going to, like, break into some sort of truffle shuffle at some point. I don't know. Something like that. You know his sort of dance moves, don't you? This would be a massive win, actually, for Kofi Kingston if he could pick up a victory here over Finn Balor. But at the same time, it all depends. Like I said, the managers in this game are very overpowered at the moment. So it depends what sort of effect that both Xavier Woods and Big E Langston are going to have at ringside. At the moment, Xavier... quite content on playing his trumpet, but at the same time, we don't know what sort of effect he's going to have on the match later on. Should Finn Balor get an opportunity to go for a pin? Is that going to be a problem? Will the referee get distracted by the likes of Xavier Woods and Biggie Langston at ringside? Tornado backbreaker there by Kofi Kingston. I'm sure Kofi will be hoping to... Kofi will be hoping that... that we don't get the opportunity to see what's going to happen if he goes for that pin. Oh, Finn Balor though with a release Regalplex, sending him across. New Day rocks. New Day rocks. New Day sucks. Quesadora or Quesadilla. Chicken fajita there by Kofi Kingston. Breaking out the enchiladas. I'm hungry now. I should really eat before I really record these videos, shouldn't I? I always try and record them first so I can eat my dinner while I'm editing, but now I just end up sitting here starving hungry while I'm trying to record these matches. Dropkick to the back there by Kofi Kingston. Kofi's probably one of the most synonymous guys. Is that the right word? Synonymous? Synonymous? Is that the opposite of unanonymous? The opposite of unanonymous is synonymous. Match, you didn't know what I mean. Kofi's pretty well known for the Rumble, because he always seems to pull out some sort of trick every year, be it jumping onto somebody's shoulders, or I think the other year didn't he jump onto the announce table and used JBL's chair to roll himself back to the ring. He's also managed to get all the way across the barricade, which is pretty cool as well. So he's always been pretty interested in these Rumbles. Of course, That's not the sort of thing you can do on this game, of course, jumping from the apron, but it's not a problem. I'm sure we can find something for Kofi to do. But again, it's gonna come down. I'm going to have to go through. Obviously, like I said earlier on, I want to put as many people in the Rumble as possible that I would like to see main event Mania, because I don't want to end up with a Virgil situation again, like I mentioned earlier on, where Virgil wins the Rumble and I have to do Virgil versus The Undertaker at bloody WrestleMania. So I think we'll definitely try and get as many top people in there as possible. There's the coup de grace. There's the pin. And it looks like Big E and Xavier Woods are not going to get involved, but Kofi Kingston did kick out at a two. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Another chicken enchilada there, this time by Finn Balor. Now dropping an elbow into the inside the knee of Kofi Kingston. And Francesca's not having much luck at ringside, distracting Finn Balor in this one. Balor is all business here. He knows that he needs this motivation. He knows that he needs this momentum going forward into the Rumble. He's desperate to win it. One, two, and again, it's only a two count. But of course, like I said, I've got big plans for Finn. Even if he doesn't win the Rumble, he's got a pretty damn good place on the WrestleMania card. I've got that sorted already. And he's got a decent feud going into our next pay-per-view as well. Let me know in the comment section below, what do you want to see our next pay-per-view be? Like I said, I think it's supposed to be Fastlane. Although I think Roadblock could work pretty well for the road to WrestleMania. We could always do Elimination Chamber, but I don't think the Chamber matches are working very well at the moment. But I was always a big fan of No Way Out as well, so No Way Out could be a potential pay-per-view name. But let me know what sort of pay-per-view Lou would like to see. Do you want to just stick with Fastlane and just stick to realism? Or shall we go a little bit outside the box and change things? Finn back up top once again. Oh, this could be the end of Kofi Kingston. This one, a second coup de grace. Big E knows what's coming. There's the pin. One, two, and three. And there is a big, big win there for Finn Balor. Xavier Woods puts Francesca down. He's not impressed. I want to see what happens if Kofi would have won that. Well, we saw what happened with Enzo Amore in the last match where he hopped up onto the apron. So I wonder what both Big E and Xavier Woods would have done if Kofi had won this match. But I want to do some more of these. I want to try and get some more singles matches with the New Day at ringside. Maybe even a tag team match Xavier Woods at ringside with the old the trombone. And here comes our main event of the evening. It is supposed to be Brock Lesnar accompanied to the ring by Paul Heyman. The controller's there for Paul Heyman, but I can't actually see him. I'm hoping he is there. And of course, we also have Chris Jericho accompanied by Kevin Owens. Of course, both Owens and Brock Lesnar will be in the ring together this Sunday at the Royal Rumble, of course, accompanied by Sami Zayn in a triple threat match for the Universal Championship. Let's see if Paul Heyman actually makes his way to the ring here. There he is. Yeah, Paul Heyman is there. So it's an interesting battle of the managers in this one, really. Paul Heyman at the ringside for Brock Lesnar. Kevin Owens, the Universal Champion, at ringside for Chris Jericho. And it's going to be very, very difficult for Owens, I think, to walk out of Royal Rumble as the champion. It's going to be very, very difficult. This man here, Brock Lesnar, is an absolute beast. And I think Owens' best chance of getting the win at the Rumble is going to be to completely eliminate Lesnar, maybe sticking him outside, doing some damage on the ring steps maybe, or using a weapon, and then coming into the ring and try to finish off Sami Zayn. I think that's going to be his best opportunity, really, of pulling this one off. And how good is this? We don't often see Brock Lesnar wrestling on Monday Night Raw, do we? But here he is, the beast incarnate. And I'm sure this will be pretty interesting, this will. Pretty interesting. It'll be interesting to see if Kevin Owens tries to get any effect on this match, tries to distract Brock Lesnar in any way. And would that be a wise thing for Kevin Owens to do? Because obviously distracting Brock Lesnar could just pee him off even more. And then Lesnar could end up becoming more and more aggressive towards Kevin Owens this Sunday at the Royal Rumble. So here comes Jericho. Where is he? Where is Jericho? There we go. The lights go off. The arms go out. I quite like the fact that he's got a flashing coat. Even though we have used Jericho already, haven't we, so far in this universe, when we noticed that the lights that flash don't actually match up with the lights on his jacket. You look, they're just a little bit out. There you go, look, you can see they're just a little bit out there. They're slightly out, the flashes, compared to where the lights actually are on his shirt. Don't matter. I have noticed, though, something that does annoy me a little bit on this game is you see that Kevin Owens is the Universal Champion, however, he's not got the belt around his waist at the moment. Last week, we did Kevin Owens with a promo, and he came out for the promo again without the championship around his waist, which is a little bit annoying. I'd like to see, if you are the champion, have the belt on at all times. If you're in a cutscene backstage, have the belt on. I think that would be a nice little addition into the game, just to make it feel a little bit more realistic, because the idea of Kevin Owens just leaving his belt somewhere backstage when he comes out to help his friend here, Jericho, just seems a little bit off for me. I don't know, I might be completely wrong. You might not agree with me on that one, but I just think he should have the belt around his waist for this. But there we go. Wow. 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 That was me doing the Jericho music, not being an angry cat, I promise. So the bell hasn't even gone yet, and already Lesnar just pelts across the ring and German suplex Chris Jericho. Lesnar, I don't think having Owens at ringside is really going to help Jericho in this situation, because I think Lesnar is just going to put on a class here, and he's going to show Kevin Owens exactly what to expect this Sunday. I think Lesnar's going to go out there purposely to try and destroy Jericho as early as possible. But Jericho, so far, in control of this one. Now, we know that Jericho and Brock Lesnar had a little bit of backstage heat recently after the SummerSlam match, wasn't it, where Lesnar busted open Randy Orton. It was a little bit unclear about what actually did happen. But by all accounts, Jericho asked somebody backstage if that was the finish it was supposed to be. And they said, we can't say. And then Jericho said, that was bullshit. Now, Jericho was saying that was bullshit, as in, it's bullshit, you can't tell me if that was the finish. But he said it just as Brock Lesnar walked through the curtains. And Lesnar thought that he was talking about his match. And apparently Lesnar then came along, picked up Jericho by the throat and pinned him up against the wall and shouted at him. Now, that was apparently what happened backstage from various online sources here and there. Whether that's exaggerated or true, I don't know. But there was that little bit of heat backstage. It'd be interesting if this match ever did happen in real life. Whether that sort of thing would happen. But we'll find out. T-bone suplex there by Brock Lesnar on Chris Jericho. Now, Lesnar, of course, is the highest rated out of these two by about 10 skill points, maybe even more, on this game. So he should have an easy victory. But then again, we had the same situation. We had an even bigger situation last week with Curtis Axel and Braun Strowman. And it was Strowman who came out with the victory last week. So it's very difficult to tell, isn't it, really? Lesnar now just stomping on the gut of Chris Jericho. Now stomping on the leg as well. Lesnar, big right hand to Jericho. And a Saito suplex. Jericho with the arm drag on Lesnar. Bringing Lesnar back up to his feet. Oh, and Lesnar just takes him over. A little collegiate style wrestling move there. Takedown on Chris Jericho. And now Lesnar with a standing Kimura lock on Jericho. But Jericho fights back with that right hand. Front chancery on Lesnar. And Jericho's getting a lot more aggression this match than he thought he would do. Now sending Lesnar to the outside with that clothesline. Now Jericho out there to join him. Lesnar just tripping Jericho over now, though. Bringing him back up to his feet. Well, Jericho sending Lesnar into the corner. And it looks like Kevin Owens has sent a chair into the ring. He has the referee distracted, and Jericho has the chair. Oh, straight across Brock Lesnar. Jericho throwing the chair out the ring before the referee gets a chance to see exactly what happened. And Jericho, with a pin, Wow, Jericho just attacked Lesnar with a chair and he only got a one count. Jericho could live to rue that day as Lesnar's back up to his feet. Gets around the back of Jericho, German suplex, Lesnar. Jericho, I think you've just pissed Lesnar off. Jericho, you are in such a bad situation right now. third German suplex. What on earth is that popped up for? I'm not even playing the game. It's AI versus AI. I don't know why that's popped up. It's since the patch. I mean, that's what it is. Since the patch, it sort of refreshed all the hints and tips. So Kevin Owens there distracting Lesnar, who was in dominant form again there against Jericho off that trio of Germans. Now Jericho getting the opportunity to try and get back into this one. There's the pin. Two, only a two count. Lesnar kicks out. Jericho now, it's Jericho taunting Lesnar. Taunting Lesnar by using his own little taunt. That was the word taunt quite a lot in there, wasn't it? Jericho now tripping Lesnar over. And he's going to roll him over middle of the ring for the Walls of Jericho. Now, this is interesting here by Lesnar. He could survive this with his UFC background. He probably should survive this. However, he knows that the longer he stays in this, the more damage could be done. And he has to think about this Sunday at the Royal Rumble, doesn't he? Lesnar now reverse suplex. Jericho hitting the mat hard. And now Lesnar showing Jericho how it's done. Lesnar bringing Jericho back up to his feet. Over the rope. Jericho does hold on. Could be a bad decision there for Jericho, though. As Lesnar getting a bit close to Kevin Owens there. And Lesnar just sending Jericho straight into the ring post. See, Owens avoiding Kevin Owens here. Owens avoiding Brock Lesnar, should I say. Lesnar taking him up and slams him down. There is the F5 into the pin. One, two, and no, it's only a two count. Jericho kicked out. How insane is that? Jericho just kicked out of an F5. That is pretty insane. But may Jericho go on to actually regret that decision. Maybe he should have just taken the pin and left this one. But he wants to win this one. He wants to knock down Brock Lesnar for his best friend, Kevin Owens. Jericho, brainbuster. Pin now one, two, no, only one count. Wow. Lesnar showing that he is no slouch here. Jericho now springboard frog splash with a rotation on there as well. Landing right in the back of Brock Lesnar. And Jericho now maybe getting a little bit too comfortable here. Jericho bringing Lesnar back up to his feet. Backbreaker as well. Maybe trying to weaken that back potentially for another Walls of Jericho. Or maybe he might not get a chance. Lesnar, German, second German, holds the grip and rolls the hip. In for a third German suplex. Again, Kevin Owens has the referee distracted, but Lesnar doesn't even go for the pin. Lesnar didn't go for the pin, but here he is now lining Chris Jericho up, takes him up onto the shoulders once again for a second time in the match. And drops him face first in for the F5. There's the pin. Owens can't believe it. Now Owens up on the apron. Referee distracted by Kevin Owens here. And Lesnar cannot be happy with the effect that Kevin Owens is having here at ringside. Big kick to the back there by Lesnar on Jericho. Jericho taking Owens down. And now Jericho looking to roll Brock Lesnar over. Where's Kevin Owens gone? Where did Kevin Owens go? Has he been ejected from ringside? I didn't see. I was paying too much attention to what was happening in the ring. I didn't even see. It looks like Owens has been ejected from ringside. So Jericho's talisman has now disappeared. But he may have done enough work here. Or maybe not, as Jericho's back up. Sorry, Lesnar's back up, should I say. Stretch muffler. I do enjoy a good stretch muffler. Jericho does fight free, though. Lesnar sending Jericho into the corner. Maybe letting Jericho be pinned in this one was the nicest thing for Kevin Owens to possibly do. Lesnar super German suplex. Oh, Jericho just needs to be put out of his misery here, doesn't he? Needs to be put out of his misery, but Owens just does not want to do it. Lesnar does not want to do it. He wants to continue the assault. Gut wrench suplex. Big kick to the back there by Lesnar on Jericho as well. Lesnar sending Jericho into the corner. Big clothesline to the back. And this is the exact form that Paul Heyman was hoping to get Brock Lesnar in here for his championship match this Sunday at the Royal Rumble. There's one German. There's a second German. Holds the grip and rolls the hip in for the third German suplex. And my word, Chris Jericho is going to be in pieces at the end of this. Oh, but Jericho, they've taken Owens. I keep calling him Owens. It's Lesnar. Taking Lesnar down. Vertical suplex by Jericho. Can Jericho pull this off? It would be an absolute masterstroke if Jericho could pull this off. Jericho. Codebreaker. Jericho hits a codebreaker on Lesnar. This could be enough. This could be enough. Jericho in for the pin. One. Two. Oh, Lesnar kicked out now. Oh, Lesnar kicked out. Jericho now goes up top. Big elbow drop. Jericho can't believe it. He thought he had this match won after that codebreaker. Jericho now, is he looking for another Walls of Jericho? No, he's going to just kick Lesnar right in the gut. And again, Jericho goes for the pin, but it's only there for a two count. Jericho really getting the crowd behind him now. He needs to try and concentrate exactly on Brock Lesnar, though, because Lesnar's no slouch. If Lesnar gets an opportunity here, he could finish Jericho off in no time. Jericho again tripping Lesnar. Looking to roll him over into the Walls of Jericho, and it's very much centre in the ring once again. Lesnar's not one to tap, but like I said, he might be thinking about Sunday. This match has been going for quite some time, considering he does have that big triple threat match on Sunday. Lesnar does fight free, though. And taking Jericho up on his shoulders. And this is what I said, as soon as Lesnar gets the opportunity, he will flatten Jericho. There's the F5, the third time in the match, and this time, surely, Kevin Owens is not here to save him. And that is the free count. Brock Lesnar picking up the nice bit of momentum going forward into the Royal Rumble. So there is the win for Lesnar. Paul Heyman's convinced here that he's got himself the next Universal Champion in Lesnar. And to tell the truth, you can't really see much different, can you, at the moment? Lesnar's been absolutely dominant. Kevin Owens tried his best to try and get his best friend Chris Jericho to win this match. But eventually Jericho was left alone as Owens was banned from ringside. So everyone, that is the end of this episode. I hope you have enjoyed it. Of course, if you have, then please do let me know by hitting that like button. It just really helped me out. And of course, if you are new around here and you want to see some more, hit the subscribe button as well. That was a lot of talking, that, wasn't it? Yeah, let me know what you thought about the promo as well. Would you rather me continue doing promos like that, where I just talk myself and try and write a half-decent promo? Of course, you may have noticed I'm not very good at promos, but, you know, it's better because it's sort of, at least we can talk about stuff that is going to be involved in the match, and the actual storylines we're going for. So let me know if you did prefer that. And yeah, I've been Chabby Gamer. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you very, very soon for our next episode of SmackDown.